नमस्कार, स्वागत है आप सभी का एनसीईआरटी के लाइव फोन इन कार्यक्रम में। मेरा नाम है तन्वी खुराना और आप हमें देख रहे हैं स्वयं प्रभा के चैनल नंबर 31 यानी कि 31 किशोर मंच पर। आप हमें यूट्यूब पर भी देख रहे हैं, हमारा चैनल है एनसीईआरटी ऑफिशियल। और आज का जो हमारा विषय है जिस पर हम चर्चा करने वाले हैं वो है रूरल डेवलपमेंट। आइए मिलते हैं हमारे एक्सपर्ट से। मैम है डॉक्टर जया सिंह।
नमस्कार, मैं एनसीईआरटी में ही काम करती हूँ और ये जो टॉपिक है रूरल डेवलपमेंट, वी हैव ऑलरेडी इंट्रोड्यूस टू द लर्नर इन क्लास 9th द फॉर्म ऑफ स्टोरी ऑफ विलेज पालमपुर। अगेन इन क्लास 11th वी हैव अ टॉपिक ऑन रूरल डेवलपमेंट। तन्वी, आपने पूछा
मैं भी पूछती हूँ मैम।
हाँ,
एक मिनट दीजिए, मैं अपने व्यूअर्स को बता दूं कि अच्छा। अगर आपके पास कोई भी सवाल है तो आप हमें भेज सकते हैं यूट्यूब के जरिए, अपने कमेंट सेक्शन में अपने सवाल लिख दीजिए और अगले आधे घंटे डॉक्टर जया सिंह मैम हमारे साथ हैं और आपके सभी सवालों का जवाब देंगी। तो आइए अपनी डिस्कशन शुरू करते हैं। मैम, सबसे पहले रूरल डेवलपमेंट, उसकी जरूरत क्यों होती है, एग्जैक्टली रूरल डेवलपमेंट होता क्यों है?
हाँ, ये बहुत ही अच्छा और बेसिक क्वेश्चन है। रूरल डेवलपमेंट बेसिकली होलिस्टिक डेवलपमेंट ऑफ रूरल एरियाज होता है और यहाँ पे वी रेफर टू एक्शंस इनिशिएशंस विच कैन लीड टू डेवलपमेंट ऑफ रूरल एरियाज। हमारे देश में वी फाइंड रूरल पीपल हैव लो इनकम एंड देयर प्रोडक्शन प्रोडक्ट देयर परचेजिंग पावर इज लो। So how do we, what steps should we take to improve their conditions and how, what sort of livelihood they have that is sustainable, they should not have unemployment, the livelihood should be sustainable, that is they should be engaged in production activities throughout the year.
Right.
So through these steps you can have improvement in the rural life of the rural people in the rural areas.
Okay, ma'am, what are the problems faced by the rural farmers?
Before I go for this, I like to have development. It's on the screen also. How World Bank has defined rural areas. World Bank says there's a strategy designed to improve the economic and social well-being of a specific group of people in rural areas. So now when we are discussing about the rural development, yes, we'll take up what are the problems that is faced by the rural people. Okay, so we'll come back to the problems in stepwise. So first problem relates to their production. Their production, that means the productivity of the farm is low. So when they sell their produce, they get low income to it. And the second problem relates to the credit, that is they get credit from the money lenders who charge exorbitant rate of interest from them. So they are caught in vicious cycle of poverty. The third problem relates to the policy. The policy framed for the rural farmers are not that favorable for them. Probably it is not meeting their problems or it's not justifying the needs for their development. Then the price of their agriculture produce, that is very volatile. When there is a bumper crop, the price of the crops goes down, and when there is a failure in the failure of the monsoon, there is hardly any production in the field. So the farmer tend to face problems and even goes to the extent of committing suicide. Last problem deals with the market. They are not connected to the market, that is market which fetch them high price for the product. They are not connected, so they tend to sell their produce in the rural areas also only, and that gives them distress. They tend to they have distress sale, that is they get very low price for their products. So the problems as shown in the screen are production related to the production, credit, policy, price and market. So these are the main problem faced by the farmers in the rural areas.
Okay, all right ma'am. So I'm sure there's a relationship between agriculture and industry.
Yeah.
What is it? Can you highlight a few things about it?
Yeah, there is a very important relationship between agriculture and industry. So long, rural area has not developed. Before that, I would like to say, in rural areas, you have mostly agriculture. Mm-hmm. 50% of the population in case of India are dependent upon agriculture in the rural areas. And so long this area does not develop, there will be no development in the industrial areas. Mm-hmm. There are reasons for it.
Okay.
Agriculture provides raw materials as well as labor to the industry.
Mm-hmm.
So if there is no surplus production in the rural field, that means industry is also not getting optimum amount of raw material for their production.
Mm-hmm.
And industry too will not provide good to the agriculture. Mm-hmm. Because in agriculture also there is a shortage of the purchasing power of the farmers.
Yeah.
So there is a direct relationship. Agriculture provides goods and labor to the industry.
Mm-hmm.
Industry provides finished goods to the labor. And if the agriculture production has gone down, it means it will be providing less to the industry, and the industry in turn will be providing less to the rural area. So if you have to industrialize your economy, mm-hmm. you have to develop the rural areas. And it has happened not only in India, but it's happened in a place like England also. England, when it generated surplus from its agriculture field,
mm-hmm.
then there was industrialization in England.
Mm-hmm.
Without the generation of surplus from the agriculture field, England would not have seen industrial revolution. So it was basically surplus generated from the agriculture in the rural areas which prompted industrialization in UK.
Okay. All right, ma'am. That's very interesting.
Yeah.
Okay, ma'am. Why and how is that the need for diversification into other production activities?
Okay. I like to take it to the screen. Diversification means there's not only change in the cropping pattern, there's a change or shift of the workforce from the farm activities towards the non-farm activities. These non-farm activities are looking after the livestock,
mm-hmm.
engaged in pisciculture, that is cultivation of fish, or rearing of fish, floriculture, rearing of flowers, poultry, looking after the poultry farms, and there are many other allied activities which are related to agriculture. I have a data. I would like to say how diversification has taken place in case of India. You can see there has been increase in the cultivation of paddy and wheat. If you look at the figure from 1960 to 2004-05, the wheat, paddy and nutri cereals have the production of paddy and nutri cereals have not increased much. But since you have asked about the diversification, and if you look at the data, you will find the production of fruits and vegetables, floriculture have increased. You can see it has increased from 10.5 to 18.8 in case of fruits and vegetables, and floriculture it has increased from 0.3 to 0.9, whereas there has not been much increase in case of paddy and wheat and nutri cereals. What does this mean? This means that in our country there is a diversification from the consumption of cereal towards the consumption of fruits and vegetables and other non-farm activities, like looking after, and that's what I have already discussed, livestock, looking after the cattle, goats.
Right.
So these are the changes which we see over the years. You can see the production or the contribution of the cereals have gone down,
right.
whereas the contribution of fruits and vegetables, mm-hmm. floriculture have increased, and they have increased substantially.
Right.
That shows the huge diversification which has taken place in our mm-hmm. country.
Okay.
There is one question, Tanvi, would you like to read out?
Yeah, sure, ma'am. So I think Amrit Pal, and he's saying, ma'am, please guide how to prepare rural development chapter in economics. And Ujwal Kumar is saying, please refer some book to prepare.
about the rural development. Yes, how do you prepare about the rural areas?
Yes.
I would ask you to go for the primary source, that is economic survey. Then there are very good books in Indian economics specialized economists like Himanshu is working on poverty, so you can refer to his books. Okay. Then Uma and Kapila, that's another very good book which has focused on agriculture, rural development. You can refer to this book. In case you want, I can give you the whole list. You give me your email, I can send you the whole list of books which talk about the rural development.
Okay, so like you heard, ma'am, if you have if you can send us your details, then ma'am can send you the list of all the books she can refer, which can help you in your exams and in preparing the topic rural development. Thank you. Okay, ma'am, so coming towards my next question, like men, obviously, they have been involved in agriculture for so long. But then women aren't behind as well. So there's a very huge role of women when it comes to agriculture development. So can we talk about that?
Yeah, agriculture is being feminized. Now, what does that mean? This means more and more women are finding employment opportunity in the agriculture itself. I can show you through the data. See, there are three sectors in our Indian economy: agriculture, manufacturing, that is secondary sector, agriculture comes in our primary sector, and construction, that comes under our tertiary sector. Right? So construction is also under sometime included under manufacturing, and then we have service sector. Here we have given construction separately because we have a huge population working in the construction. Construction is in fact in the manufacturing sector only. So, in case of agriculture, we have taken the data from 1993 to 2011-12. You can see the screen. The data has been divided for working population in male from 1993 to 2011-12, and working population of female from 1993 to 2011-12. In case of agriculture, you, there has been decrease in men working in the field from 74% to 59%. But in case of women, it has gone down from 86% to 74% only. Whereas you find more and more male being engaged in the construction as well as in the manufacturing sector. The number of women participation has also increased, but it has not increased much. In case of manufacturing, with respect to male, it has increased from 7 to 8.2, while in case of construction for male, it has increased from 3 to 13, but in case of women, it has increased from 7.1 to 9.8 only, and you find maximum of them have been continuing to work in the field. They have not been shifted much to manufacturing or the service sector. So the data also reveals the same thing. The problem is there is a feminization of more and more women finding employment in the field. They are working in threshing, preparing the ground, laying down the seeds, manure, pesticides, fertilizers, and thrashing, and many other activities. You find the engagement of women only. The problem is they are not getting the return from the field as much as they are producing. And the reason is very simple. They are, they don't, till date, women in the field don't have property rights. Nor, since they don't have property rights, they don't, they cannot go for remunerative production activities also. That means the property rights, access to production activities are all controlled by the men.
Okay.
So now, if this is the problem, how do we solve it? It's a serious problem. They are working on it and they are not getting adequate return for it. Now, how to have a solution? It's very simple. Now, the women cultivator, their name should be recorded in the revenue records.
Okay.
That is, she is a woman and she is cultivating the field. Let her name be recorded in the revenue records. So whatever is her contribution could become transparent. Till date, she is working in a field which is registered under the male ownership. So
it's like she is not getting the credit.
She is not getting the credit. Mm. And credit not in the terms of acknowledgement. Itna kaam kiya usne. Nahin, this is not needed. The credit has to be monetized. Mm. She has to be given monetary return for whatever she is doing it. There is an engagement without which, unless or until the monetary return is assured to the women, she cannot, we cannot find improvement in the condition of women. That means she is working in the field, but she is being paid low salary, or she is being paid no salary, and so the condition of women working in the field is deplorable. And so long the condition of women working in the field does not improve, you cannot have rural development. So there is a feminization in rural areas, more and more women finding employment, but it needs to be monetized, without which you cannot have rural development.
So there's a long way for women to go.
Yeah, women to demand their rights.
And to get their rights. Finally.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Especially in the production activities. They have already got their rights in the as an engagement in the field. But they need to have returns, in the monetary returns for whatever they are doing in the field.
Okay, okay. Ma'am, so like you've mentioned a few reasons that why is rural development important and necessary. But still, can you highlight a few more reasons why actually there's a need for rural development?
Okay. Rural development, first of all, in our country, rural development is dominated by agriculture.
Right.
This is known to us. But agriculture is contributing only 14% to the GDP.
That's it?
Yes, okay. Only 14%. Maximum contribution is coming from the service sector, where engagement of where very few people are engaged around there. That means the rural area is underdeveloped. So there is a need to develop the rural areas. I'll take you to the screen and let you know why there is a need for rural development. One such reason is land labor ratio. I told you 50% of the population is engaged in agriculture. So there is a huge population working in the field. And I have given you the reason why women are not being, why the condition of women are not improving in the rural areas.
Yes.
So we need to monetize that sector also to improve the condition of women. Then there is a urban bias also, in the sense you find rural areas agriculture goods are being produced, and in urban areas industrial goods are being produced. In case of rural areas, you find agriculture goods are priced less than the industrial goods. The price of agriculture goods, take any good, take the price of wheat, take the price of rice, it's much, much less than the price of your TV, the price of your remote. And so whosoever is producing these agriculture goods gets low return for it.
Okay.
And then the agriculture economy has been developed in such a fashion that people would not like to invest in agriculture in the rural areas. They would like to invest in industries in the urban areas. So you find shares being purchased by many of us. And although I have not purchased any share, it should not be taken as such. But there is a huge investment for industrial goods. You will not find such investment for agriculture goods being made. Then exchange ratio also, the exchange rate, the rate at which your one good is exchanged for another good is priced low for agriculture goods and is priced high for industrial goods. That means if you exchange agriculture goods for industrial goods, you get low return. But if you exchange industrial goods for agriculture goods, you get high returns.
Okay.
And the third reason is unfair competition that exists in the world. I'd like to take up a macro aspect. Why is it so? Firstly, developed countries. We have developed countries like USA, Europe,
yes.
UK, and we have a developing country like India.
Yeah.
India. China is no more a developing country.
Mm.
It has improved.
Mm.
Now, what happens in the developed countries, they give subsidies.
Yeah.
Like if you are cultivating a plot A and the cost of production has come around 500, then the government gives you subsidy in the sense it says I'll pay you 250 and you bear the cost of 250 only.
Okay.
So instead of 500, the farmer is paying 250 for cultivating its plot.
Okay.
So that's subsidy
paid
by the government.
Mm.
So when the government is paying the subsidy, the price of the agriculture produce, मतलब जो सामान वहाँ उत्पादन हुआ है उसका दाम कम हो जाता है.
Okay.
जैसे price of rice is let's say is 50 rupees a kg and then the government has given you subsidy, its price comes around 25 rupees a kg.
Okay.
So what do? As a producer, you tend to produce rice and you try to sell it more and more.
Right.
And you get a better return. So what what is happening in the developed countries? They the government is giving them subsidy. So the price of agriculture goods in the developed countries becomes cheap. So what they do is they start dumping those agriculture goods in the developing countries.
Okay.
So now when there is a surplus supply of agriculture good in the developing countries, the farmers in the developing countries gets poor price for their produce. Why is it so? Because there is an abundant supply of agriculture goods in your country.
Yeah.
So when there is an abundant supply and it's not matched by the demand in the same proportion, the price of the commodity falls. And who suffers? The farmer.
The farmers.
Who has been cultivating without subsidies in the field. They were not given any subsidies. So there is an unfair competition and in the world market. And this unfair competition is visible across the world. Like this American government, it gives a subsidy for the production of maize. And Mexican farmers, they cannot sell their maize in the global market because American maize are priced very cheap. The farmers are getting the subsidies. They are getting their inputs are subsidized, so the cost of production have gone very low.
Okay.
And they and the American farmers are earning profits also, whereas the farmers in the developing countries are suffering. So there is an unfair competition. So I like to just say what are the problems, why the agriculture productivity is low.
Okay.
There is a poor land labor ratio. That means. And there is a huge population dependent upon the land.
Right.
A land, let's take a particular field which requires only 10 labor.
Right.
Since there is a huge dependence of population on the land, so instead of 10 people, you find 30 people working on that same same plot of land. So the production is shared among the 30 people. And the production which should have been for 10 people goes down or is distributed among the 30 people.
Three times that
That's it. So one such reason for poor agriculture productivity is too much dependence of the population on agriculture.
Okay.
And secondly, there is a urban bias treatment meted out to the rural areas. And the industrial areas are benefiting from it, but the rural areas have not seen the light of the day as yet. And then there's an unfair competition throughout the world, not only in India, but throughout the world.
So some rural areas of some countries, they are getting the benefit and the other rural areas from some countries, they are suffering.
Because of the subsidies, tariffs and other incentives which the government gives to their farmers.
Okay. Okay. Ma'am, so should government tax agricultural produce?
Yeah, that's a very interesting question. Again, I like to answer at the macro level. I'll take example of Japan, where there was a Meiji restoration and the government imposed tax on their produce.
Okay.
Agriculture produce in the rural areas and they saw the downfall of the government. In case of Russia, the farmers were fixed the limit that you can keep this much proportion of your produce within yourself, and you have to give the rest to the commune system, that is to the government.
So that was mandatory for them.
That was compulsory for them. Okay. Yes, they had to give it. So what was the repercussion? They started killing their animals. They started burning their produce, farm produce. They said, why should we give it to you? We have worked hard in the field. We should enjoy the fruit. So if you impose taxation, that is, you say you give half of your produce to us or half of your income to us, it will have a very bad effect. Okay. Unless until they are able to generate surplus. But in India, we did not have taxation, agriculture taxation. You have heard about Vinoba Bhave?
Yeah, yeah.
He went on from place to place pleading people, since you have a surplus land, you go for Bhudan, you donate your bhumis. So when you donate to your bhumis, the person who does not have a land will be benefited. And you will be ultimately gaining when he starts working on your land. Right. So you donate the land. Till now also we have a land ceiling. You can keep land up to this limit under a individual name. Rest of the land you have to distribute, or you should sell it away.
That sounds like a great idea.
Yeah, of course.
Did the farmers cooperate?
Yeah, the farmers, of course. Here you don't see agriculture revolution. Mm. You have seen a revolution in Russia. Government was thrown out, but you don't see any such revolution in India. No. The government never forced farmers to do this or do that. But of course, the attention has to be paid to improve their conditions. We cannot let the condition of farmers go like this.
Okay, okay, ma'am. So, can agricultural marketing help in rural development?
Yeah, I like to take it to the screen.
Yeah.
Agriculture marketing, how can it help? See, the farmers, they have to be informed about the packaging, grading, how the weights for the produce has to be done. In the absence of which, they are not informed how the grading or packaging has to be done. Mm. They are not given correct price for their produce.
Okay.
Now, why is it so? You know, and in many of our rural areas, villages are not connected to the highways. So the farmers cannot take their produce to the highways.
Okay.
That is to the main market where they can get good returns for their produce. Hmm. They tend to sell their goods to the traders.
Okay.
And the traders tends to cheat the farmers in the sense they have faulty weight. Hmm. Let's say their crops weighs 40 kg. Hmm. But due to the faulty weight, it has come around 30 kg. So he's being paid for 30 kg only, that is 10 kg less than the actual produce. Mm-hmm. And he's not literate, he's not aware of the manipulation, he tends to come with it. So there is a need for agriculture marketing.
So that used to happen, or is it still happening?
It's still happening.
Is it?
They are not getting good return for their produce. Okay. And that is why there is no risk averse. That means if you ask farmers to take loan and buy seeds, fertilizers, most of them fear, because in case they do not get good produce for their they do not get good return for their produce, then they have to be fined for it. That is why you hear farmers who have taken loans.
Yeah.
You must have read in the newspaper, they have also gone for suicide. Because the return from the produce was not enough to enable them to return their loans.
Okay.
So you have problems of agriculture produce. Problems of low price for their produce also.
Right, ma'am. Is there government policy you want to talk about?
Yeah, there are lots of government policy. I would like to refer to it. There is a housing policy, that is Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana then rural connectivity from grams, Sarak Yojana, employment through the MNREGA. Then there are several steps taken by the government to improve the quality of the life of the rural areas, like Jan Dhan Yojana is there, Swachh Bharat policy is there, Ujwala Yojana is there. So the government has taken many policies to improve the condition of the rural areas. Then education is one such factor where we are working. We want the farmers to be educated so that they cannot be cheated.
Okay. Thank you so much, ma'am, for being here, for talking to us, for talking to our viewers, and for also answering the question proposed by one of our viewers. Thank you so much for all of you for watching this program. And this was very informative program, because ma'am told us a few situations by England and by Japan, which I was not aware of. Okay, so we have to end this session right now, but let me tell you the topic for tomorrow. Tomorrow at 11:30 we'll come back again on the same channel at the same time. The topic will be basis of curriculum design. If you have any questions regarding this topic, then please send it to us. Our email ID is ciet.kishoremunch@gmail.com. till then, thank you so much. Namaskar.